let them take the lead. On behalf of USI, I would like to thank your entire team for doing this event. The topic that Ravinder has given me is local therapy, when and why. We heard the beautiful talks by rheumatologists, we heard about systemic therapy. So basic question that we ask, is uveitis a local disease? No. Why is it not? Because one, uveitis may be a manifestation of a systemic disease, like we heard Behçet's, multiple sclerosis and all that, tuberculosis. And secondly, even if the response is local, once you have the uveitis, it no longer remains local because of something called anterior chamber associated immune deficiency. So normally we all say that eye is an immunologically privileged organ. And why so? Because it has a very strong anatomical barrier which gets broken or which gets breached in the uveitis. And it also has an immunological barrier which again gets breached in uveitis. And this is what ACAD is. I'm not going to elaborate in detail, but the thing is, once the antigens cross the eye, they get converted into Treg cells. And these Treg cells have a way of going into the spleen and residing there. So even if for a moment you believe that there is no systemic disease and it is only uveitis, but the very fact that you're both anatomical as well as immunological barriers have been broken, it is no longer confined only to the eye. So we come to the question that Ravinder raised. Local therapy, we all understand and we have been hearing a lot that there is still a lot of local therapy which we all give. And the question is when and why? So let me give you some examples of cases when we would still use a local therapy. Now, this is my case number one. This is a very young patient who's a 19-year-old child. He comes to us from Rajasthan and he complains of, can we have this light on, please? Insidious, gradually progressive loss of vision. If we look at it, vision is really low. Hand motions close to face and counting fingers. And this is what his right eye looks like. There is whole lot of media haze and there is this kind of fibrovascular proliferation that we are seeing. Media was hazy and you know, for the moment I thought probably there was a toxocarid granuloma sitting somewhere because it was that marked. And this is how it is the right eye. So media is hazed, we have this vascularized retina fold and we did not see any granuloma in the periphery. This was the left eye where again the media was hazy. There was vitritis, there was disc edema and we had snowballs. Now this is when we did the fluorescein angiography, we realized that fold was there but then capillaries all over the fundus were leaking. And same was in the left eye, there was diffuse leakage from the capillary bed and we also had this new vascularization sitting here, which means the barriers are now broken and there is active inflammation. And in the late phase, of course, there was leakage, pooling and everything. So when you have this child bilateral disease, what are your thoughts? Looking at the pattern, and mainly because it was the capillary leak, we first thought, could it be Behçet's? Or, of course, idiopathic retinal vasculitis, intermediate uveitis. Infections was really not high on the cards, but we like to rule it out. For example, TB vasculitis and all. So when we did investigations, we honestly did not find anything, including the ultrasound abdomen and gastric lavage and all that. So we had a working diagnosis of intermediate uveitis with vasculitis and we gave him IV methylprednisolone because bilateral disease, we do not like to treat with the local therapy. So rheumatology consult, and then of course adalimumab, we just heard MMF added as a steroid sparing, and in addition the left eye which had NBE also received a ranibizumab injection. So you can see here at presentation the right eye 2 months later and 6 months later, we could maintain a vision of 20/200. Left eye from counting finger, we went to 20/40, 6 months later on biologic and MMF. And so the fluorescein also shows decrease in the leakage, and the NVE which has decreased and then it reappeared again as required. Now the question is, if you look at this eye, there is still a leakage which is less than what it was before. The top end shows before, the bottom shows it is responding on one biologic, on one immunosuppression, but it is not really totally quiet eye. The right eye is responding better. So what would you do now? Because there is now an asymmetry between the two eyes on systemic therapy. One eye needs more. So would you add a second immunosuppression on top of biologics, or would you supplement locally the eye which is not doing so well, or which is doing well but needs more immunosuppression than the opposite eye? So here are the choices which I already mentioned. Meantime, when we were debating on this, patient complained of pain in the chest and fever, so he underwent further investigations for the same. So this is what the baseline chest, as highlighted by our rheumatologist friends. So we always get a baseline chest before you are starting the patient on biologics. This was normal. However, when we repeated, there is a subpleural nodule with pleural thickening, and he has been diagnosed as fungal infection, which means adding our steroids or anything to whatever is happening is out of question. So this will be my first situation, is when one of the eyes needs additional therapy in the background of systemic therapy which is already ongoing, that is when I will add a local therapy. And why? Because I don't want to expose the rest of the body to unnecessarily risk and the side effects of additional systemic therapy. Then comes to my second situation, is retinal vasculitis or intermediate uveitis. This is a unilateral disease, and we most commonly have macular edema associated with this. So these are the kind of the situations which will respond very well to system to local therapy. And Dr. Gupta has already shown the POINT study where they found that whether you give a DEXA implant or TRISENSE, actually the result is the same. We still feel more comfortable with DEXA implant, but mainly because of the issues related to the sterility and other things, and not primarily because of the drug. The drugs, both of them work equally well. So my second would be, if I have a unilateral disease with no underlying systemic disease, local would be my first choice of therapy. Then we come to another situation. This is my third situation, is toxoplasma. Now, for example, this lady was actually 2 weeks pregnant, but she may not be pregnant otherwise also, but pregnancy, yes, you cannot give antitoxosystemic. So you have this focus, which is now a new focus of toxo, and you do fluorescein. Professor Gupta showed beautifully how you can differentiate retinitis from choroiditis on fluorescein. So you see, this is an active disease. So what do? You just give the local injection, because that is the safest one to do, and you can see this responding to therapy. Or even otherwise, when you have a patient, now we are giving local therapy more and more for toxoplasma. And sometimes in patients who have multiple recurrences, we add oral ceftriaxone as a prophylactic for preventing recurrences. So this is one such example where we have treated this patient only with local antitoxotherapy. So the third indication will be local therapy for infective uveitis. It works very well, provided you know what the infection is and you can give specific antibiotic or antiparasitic therapy. It works super well. So that would be my indication for giving a local therapy. Then we come to another scenario, like this is fourth situation. This is a young girl and she has been very well managed in Mumbai for serpiginous like choroiditis. So, you know, she looks very fine, but still she complains of some metamorphopsia. She went to Hyderabad, she went couple here and there, and she said, I have metamorphopsia, but most what we were seeing is beautifully scarred retina, at least in the right eye. However, when you do, she is receiving immunosuppression, enhanced immunosuppression, because she was symptomatic. And many times when we don't understand and the patients keep complaining, we just add something to get rid of them. So she was on azathioprine, which was subsequently added on top of ATT. But when you do OCT, you see this hyperreflective material here, subretinal hyperreflective, which on angio-OCT shows that there is an underlying choroidal neovascular membrane. So these are the kind of the patients where increasing the immunosuppression, giving steroids, doing all that stuff is not going to help, because the cause of this metamorphopsia is not activity of choroiditis. This is the development of new vessels under that choroiditis patch. So she would need a local therapy. This case you saw in the morning, and some of who joined later. This is a classic patient of PIC that Anirudh showed. So you see these lesions of punctate inner choroidopathy, which you cannot mistake. We all understand that once we diagnose it as PIC, patient needs systemic immunosuppressive therapy, and there is no local treatment for this. However, what we were sometimes missing is that even during the acute phase, if you see that there is a Bruch's membrane which is elevated and you do a OCT angio that shows a little new vascular membrane, you have to add local therapy to it. That does not mean that you are not giving systemic therapy for PIC that you are giving. You are just adding a supplement local therapy, because in this patient, for whatever reasons, it was not given, and you can see the new vascular membrane progressing over a period of 6 months, despite the fact the lady was on immunosuppressive therapy. So, continuing with this local adjunct, this is what Mohit will be showing you later. This is a patient with TB granuloma. Many of these patients with TB granuloma have type 3 membrane, and you may see a small hemorrhage. Majority of these granulomas in TB are driven by VEGF. So if you give anti-VEGF therapy like this one, they respond very well. We were very enthusiastic about giving anti-VEGF as monotherapy in some of these patients, but I have 4 patients who have come back with the disease not only in this eye but even in the opposite eye. So never ever undermine the therapy, the role of systemic therapy in uveitis. Local is good, but be careful that it is not only the eye which has come to your clinic, it is the entire patient which has walked into your clinic. So you can see these granulomas respond beautifully well only with anti-VEGF, but don't get carried away, because if there is an underlying TB, probably it's a good idea to add anti-TB. So my fourth when and why is to manage either the complications of uveitis, or if there is any concomitant manifestations, you will add local therapy in addition to systemic. Coming to the fifth indication, is this is the patient serpiginous like choroiditis. Now you see on the top, we start anti-TB drugs. We have started him on systemic steroids, 1 mg per kg. But many a times what happens is when we start the patient on systemic therapy, they do have paradoxical worsening, like you can see here the new lesions appearing. Be careful of giving steroids more than 1.5 milligram per kg per day for a longer duration, because the risk of avascular necrosis of the hip increases very high the moment you go beyond 60 milligram a day. So similar phenomena, instead of going very high, you can manage it locally by supplementing what is being given. Again, another example of paradoxical worsening here, or a third example of paradoxical. So whenever we have paradoxical worsening in patients who are already on anti-TB drugs and steroids, there was a time when we were admitting them and giving them IV methylpred, but now we don't do that. We just supplement it with local, which could be Ozodex, which could be methotrexate, depending on our mood of the day and of course the patient's factors, like glaucoma and so many other, affordability, etc. And my last indication is not really indication, that's not a choice, like patients with lymphomas, which are very high on a rise. You see this pattern, don't forget this lumpy, bumpy, this leopard skin, always think of lymphoma, diagnostic biopsy. It proves most of them are large B-cell lymphomas, CNS may or may not be involved, but these are the patients who would need intravitreal injections of rituximab and methotrexate. Ideally, even if there are no CNS lesions, they should receive treatment for CNS lymphoma. It's kind of bit not controversial, everybody doesn't practice it that way, but even if we leave the CNS part out of it, the intravitreal lymphoma has treatment that needs local therapy. Ravinder did not ask me this question, so I'm not going to answer, is what to give. So we do have fluconazole implant, we do have dexamethasone implant, multiple studies that have proven them to be right, and of course the POINT study now that says that triamcinolone is equally effective. We do have sirolimus, which is mTOR inhibitor, and we should be starting a trial very soon for the local therapy of sirolimus. So that is SAKURA trial. So to conclude, local therapy is very good. Be sure you are dealing with non-infectious posterior uveitis, except when you are injecting antibiotics. That's a different thing, but when we are injecting steroids or methotrexate or anti-TNF for that matter, be sure that you are dealing only with the non-infectious variety. Systemic therapy, including the biologics, are effective, but they do have their severe morbidities, including the risk of reactivation of latent TB. So if your disease is localized to the eye, and if you know, you think local therapy, it is still the treatment of choice. Steroid implants cannot be administered in patients who have elevated IOP, so be very careful of the reports saying that you don't care, they don't cause too much elevation. You have to be careful while injecting. An mTOR inhibitor is not available as yet commercially, so I won't go into this. So I think the idea is to maintain a balance between the systemic and local. So in the era of customized and personalized medicine, I don't think we can give you exactly what and why, when and why. It is just depending on the patient. You look at the risk versus benefit of both the therapies and reach an optimum way where you are using both the therapies in a same patient in such a way that you are not getting the side effect of either too much systemic or too much local therapy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. That was actually a very informative talk. But there were a few questions, but I think most of them have been answered.
All the questions are for PCR and TB. Yes. So we take care of that in next time.
Next talk we'll take care of. And at present, I'd love to ask Dr. Sumit Chopra Sir to please give a memento to now.
therapy for PIC that you are giving. You are just adding a supplement local therapy, because in this patient, for whatever reasons, it was not given, and you can see the new vascular membrane progressing over a period of 6 months, despite the fact the lady was on immunosuppressive therapy. So, continuing with this local adjunct, this is what Mohit will be showing you later. This is a patient with TB granuloma. Many of these patients with TB granuloma have type 3 membrane, and you may see a small hemorrhage. Majority of these granulomas in TB are driven by VEGF. So if you give anti-VEGF therapy like this one, they respond very well. We were very enthusiastic about giving anti-VEGF as monotherapy in some of these patients, but I have 4 patients who have come back with the disease not only in this eye but even in the opposite eye. So never ever undermine the therapy, the role of systemic therapy in uveitis. Local is good, but be careful that it is not only the eye which has come to your clinic, it is the entire patient which has walked into your clinic. So you can see these granulomas respond beautifully well only with anti-VEGF, but don't get carried away, because if there is an underlying TB, probably it's good idea to add anti-TB. So my 4th when and why is to manage either the complications of uveitis, or if there is any concomitant manifestations, you will add local therapy in addition to systemic. Coming to the 5th indication, is this is the patient's serpiginous-like choroiditis. Now you see on the top, we start anti-TB drugs. We have started him on systemic steroids, 1 milligram per kg. But many a times what happens is when we start the patient on systemic therapy, they do have paradoxical worsening. Like you can see here, the new lesions appearing. Be careful of giving steroids more than 1.5 milligram per kg per day for a longer duration, because the risk of avascular necrosis of the hip increases very high the moment you go beyond 60 milligram a day. So similar phenomena, instead of going very high, you can manage it locally by supplementing what is being given. Again, another example of paradoxical worsening here, or a third example of paradoxical. So whenever we have paradoxical worsening in patients who are already on anti-TB drugs and steroids, there was a time when we were admitting them and giving them IV methylpred, but now we don't do that. We just supplement it with local, which could be Ozodex, which could be methotrexate, depending on our mood of the day and of course the patient's factors, like glaucoma and so many other, affordability, etc. And my last indication is not really indication, that's not a choice, like patients with lymphomas, which are very high on a rise. You see this pattern, don't forget this lumpy, bumpy, this leopard skin, always think of lymphoma, diagnostic biopsy. It proves most of them are large B-cell lymphomas. CNS may or may not be involved, but these are the patients who would need intravitreal injections of rituximab and methotrexate. Ideally, even if there are no CNS lesions, they should receive treatment for CNS lymphoma. It's kind of bit not controversial, everybody doesn't practice it that way, but even if we leave the CNS part out of it, the intravitreal lymphoma has treatment that needs local therapy. Dovinder did not ask me this question, so I'm not going to answer, is what to give. So we do have fluconazole implant, we do have dexamethasone implant, multiple studies that have proven them to be right, and of course the POINT study now that says that triamcinolone is equally effective. We do have sirolimus, which is mTOR inhibitor, and we should be starting a trial very soon for the local therapy of sirolimus. So that is Sakura trial. So to conclude, Local therapy is very good. Be sure you are dealing with non-infectious posterior uveitis, except when you are injecting antibiotics. That's a different thing, but when we are injecting steroids or methotrexate or anti-TNF for that matter, be sure that you are dealing only with the non-infectious variety. Systemic therapy, including the biologics, are effective, but they do have their severe morbidities, including the risk of reactivation of latent TB. So if your disease is localized to the eye, and if you know you think local therapy, it is still the treatment of choice. Steroid implants cannot be administered in patients who have elevated IOP, so be very careful of the reports saying that you don't care, they don't cause too much elevation. You have to be careful while injecting. An mTOR inhibitor is not available as yet commercially, so I won't go into this. So I think the idea is to maintain a balance between the systemic and local. So in the era of customized and personalized medicine, I don't think we can give you exactly what and why, when and why. It is just depending on the patient. You look at the risk versus benefit of both the therapies and reach an optimum way where you are using both the therapies in a same patient in such a way that you are not getting the side effect of either too much systemic or too much local therapy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. That was actually a very informative talk you provided. But there were a few questions, but I think most of them have been answered.
All the questions are for PCR and TB. Yes. Yeah. So we take care of that in next time.
Next talk we'll take care of. And at present, I'd like to ask Dr. Sumit Chopra Center, please give a memento to ma'am.